come to the edge. We might fall. Come to the edge. It's too high. Come to the edge. And they came, and we pushed, and they flew. That poem by Christopher Logue was Cecily's favorite. Her mantra, her advice for herself and all others. Despite a childhood not entirely devoid of Dickensian elements, and an innate anxiety and fearful nature, she pushed through her fears time and time again, bringing herself repeatedly to the edge, and more often than not, stepping off and soaring like an egret. My name is Jim Beaver, and for 15 years, I had the unutterable joy, the magnificent honor, the recurrent exasperation, and the staggering fun of being married to Cecily Adams. Today, I will do my best to get through this public part of the worst thing in my life. As a responsible actor, I have an understudy. We will hear about Cess's family. We will hear from Cess's family, friends, and colleagues about a girl who brought an astonishing amount of vivacity into so many lives and whose departure has left bereft so many hearts. Her birth certificate, an omen of indecisiveness to come, read, "Baby Girl Yarmy." Cecily April Adams, as she was finally named, was born February 6, 1958, or 1965, depending on what the role called for. Her father, an up-and-coming comic named Don Adams, remarried and moved to Hollywood not long after her birth, and Cecily was raised in Silver Spring, Maryland, by her singer-dancer mom, Adelaide. The family came west eventually, and Cess attended Beverly Hills High and UC Irvine, performing in plays and musicals. After college, she set out to be an actor. She liked to tell of her first restaurant job in Hollywood when, hearing a waiter mention an audition he'd gone on, she said, "Oh my God, you're an actor? Me too!" She began to get gigs playing teenagers on Quincy and Simon & Simon and in commercials. And then her aunt, Alice Borden, suggested she join Theater West, the prestigious theater company and workshop. She did, and she remained an active member there for 20 years. That's where I met her. I was an actor and writer, just beginning to get a few breaks. I had won an election to the theater's board of directors, and Cess, whom I knew only in passing, came up to congratulate me. She surprised me by kissing me on the cheek, and then she sucker-punched me by saying, "That was nice," and doing it again on the other cheek. And she left and got in her car. I stood there a second, shook the stars out of my head, and then ran to my car and chased her down the street until she caught me. It was Monday, August 25th, 1985. For a woman who liked to look nine ways before crossing the street, those kisses on the cheek were a defining and glorious moment of impulsiveness for which I will be grateful all my life. I proposed to Cess for 4 years before she gave me an answer. I don't mean before she accepted, before she answered. It was a question she was determined not to answer wrong, and so she didn't answer it at all. Just acted as if I hadn't said anything. Every time. For 4 years. Now, I admit that as a package, I could bear some inspecting. Finally, in 1989, I guess I passed inspection. She was afraid of marriage, never having seen it work, and all too aware of the potential for sorrow and anguish when it failed. So, as with so many things she feared, she stepped off the edge, trusting in her determination to give her wings. 15 years later, we were still flying. It was not always easy. I'm immature and undisciplined, and she was harder headed than Mount Rushmore. So we fought sometimes. Of course she fought. She's Greek, Italian, Hungarian, and Irish. She could have done World War I as a one-woman show. But she always fought for something, some goal, some betterment, never merely against. She had the passion and courage of her convictions to a greater extent than anyone I've ever known. She was a scared little girl who always stood up for herself. She was wounded and angry and bitter at betrayal, and she responded by being loving and charming and by embracing life and the community of her fellow man. She was the bravest scaredy cat and the most spiritual misanthrope who ever lived. And what did she get for it? Simply more love, more friends, more unashamed adoration than she ever dreamed or could have dreamed. You have to know how brave she was. Her daughter Maddie, whom she struggled against Promethean odds and months of physical ordeal to bring into this world, was worth any sacrifice to her. When she learned of her illness, she told the doctors, "I don't care how much pain I have. I don't care how sick you have to make me to beat this. Bring it on. I have a daughter to raise." It was far worse than she imagined, and yet she never retreated an inch for her own comfort. So what memorial do we build for this brave girl? I challenge each of you who knew her, who admired her, who delighted in her, and who loved her, to examine those moments when fear pulls you back, and then to hear the voice of a girl who, despite her conviction that disaster lay around every corner, always pressed forward. Come to the edge.
Of course, I waited until the night before this event to endeavor to draft something to say today. I've been busy organizing, delegating, bossing folks around in order to put something together that would make a certain someone proud. This has served two purposes. A, it's given me a place to hide from the unspeakable reality of why we're gathering, and B, it's automatic for me. It's automatic for me because a certain someone taught me how to do this, how to produce, how to put on a show. I keep saying a certain someone because there's no way that we can be having a memorial service for my sister, Cecily. Simply, cannot be real. The first and only sign I have that Cecily is not around is that under normal circumstances, she would be here doing this with me. She was my partner, my confidant, my playmate, my teacher. Reaching back to my earliest memories, Cess was always there. For those of you who are not familiar with the Adams family saga, I'll try to trim an epic. Cess is my half-sister, different mothers, same genetically domineering father. Cess's mother, Dell, is a petite brunette a la Audrey Hepburn, my mother, a glamorous blonde a la Grace Kelly. Cess and I both came out looking like a certain popular 1960s television comedian. The only good thing about that was that we got to look like each other. The other details of the Adams saga can be somewhat unpalatable, so I will skip to the fact that Cess, by all rights, should have disliked me even before I was born. But instead, she took the high road. She loved me intensely with all her might. This love both sustained and supported me as we navigated through turbulent family waters. But let's go back to those earlier memories. So many of you know Cecily as an adult. I knew her when she was a terrifically precocious, wildly creative tomboy and big sister. The words half-sister have never been uttered by me when I talk about Cess. Yes, we grew up in different households and early on in different states, but she would spend the summers with us. Cecily would come from her home in Maryland, where she and the other girls would watch our newly famous father on the Johnny Carson show, raving about his lovely wife, my mother, and his little girl, me. This, having been brutally hurtful, never inspired the bitterness that it might have. Instead, she came bouncing into our lives every summer for all of my childhood. My memory of those days is that she filled the house with life, imagination, and vitality. This was a huge house with many rooms, but Cecily slept in the other twin bed in my room. Each minute of each day was an adventure. From building tree houses to making Super 8 films to having dual crushes on the Van Patten boys, and chasing them around the pool. She liked Jimmy, I liked Vinny. We later learned they ended up with Victoria's Secret models or something, and we never had a chance, but. Cecily's well of creativity was bottomless. A roll of white shelving paper turned into the main street of a town done in magic markers. She would design and illustrate comic books and write the text at age 12. She would go to the set of Get Smart with our father and sit mesmerized for 13-hour days, and then come home at night and recite every word of every scene from every character verbatim. I wrote a poem at age 10, inspired by my distress about the threat of nuclear war. Don't ask. Cecily found this poem in my room and wrote me a poem back about hope and peace. 8 years my senior, or 7 and a half, as she would correct me, which makes me really young according to her fake age. So that's okay. For some, that big of a time difference in age, a lot of people would feel that it was kind of a drag to bring your little sister everywhere with you. But for Cess, it was the opposite. She took me everywhere with her. To play rehearsals at Beverly High, where I sat mesmerized and learned every word to every song in Bye Bye Birdie and many others. Our days were so full, and I never wanted them to end, but eventually my mother would force us to bed, and as the lights went out each night, Cess would make me promise, swear on my very life, and you all know the drama with which this is delivered, promise to wake her up in the morning, no matter what. Well, this was not an easy task. She was a heavy sleeper who hated getting up in the morning. She would sleep till noon if and when she could. So I would lie awake with anxiety for half the night. How will I wake her up? Morning would come, and I would sit on the edge of her bed, waiting and waiting for the clock to tick the time that I was supposed to wake her up. And then it would come, "Sass, wake up." It would start as a whisper, nothing. Then a little pat, a little nudge. "Sass, come on now, you said, wake you up, no matter what." A little more forceful with each delivery. Watching the clock all the while, then the desperation would kick in. "Cecily!" I would start to say her name, her full name, because I always just called her Cess. Now she was Cecily. "Cecily, come on, wake up." So the funny thing about this was Cecily was probably faking it because she wanted me to get to the point where I would say her name like this. "Cecily," which always happened, and she thought that was just terrifically funny. For years and years, she just tortured me. Hang on. Pages are sticking together. Later in life, when Jim and Cess took me in to live with them, not long after having taken in my brother Sean to live with them, but that's another story about how they saved both our lives by giving us love, shelter, and family at times when we felt bereft of any of those things. While I was living with them, and now we were adults, of course, Cess had a partner in crime, in sleeping crime, that is, and that was Jim, of course. They both would sleep like they'd been drugged. Through the alarm, which I would hear in the guest room across the house as if it were under my own pillow, KNX 1070 blasting the news, not classical music or something you can sleep through, you know. It's a traffic jam on the 405, but loud. My instructions didn't change over the years. I still had to wake her up, which would lead to the always attractive scene of a 30-year-old woman, me, sitting on the edge of Jim and Cess's bed, whimpering, "Cecily!" Of course, this made her laugh. Cess and I grew into more than sisters. As the years passed and our age difference became less important, we became best friends. We spent 2 months in the Philippines working for free on a movie for Roger Corman, where she got dysentery. I got marriage proposals from married Filipino men with many children. And we both learned how to say, "No fish heads, please," in Tagalog. We also met Mark Sobel. We traveled through mainland China, spent my 21st birthday there, where we were propositioned to go to the Great Wall at 10 o'clock at night with three Marines in a Camaro. After Cess yanked me by the collar out of the back seat, I realized it was maybe not the best idea. We produced plays together, wrote together, acted together. We eased each other's pain regarding a mutual need to have our father's approval and love. We had a language without even speaking out loud to each other. I imagine it may be something like having a twin. I would take such delight whenever someone would say, "You two look so much alike." But it was more than looks. It was mannerisms, our voices, our propensity for drama. It was more than even that. It was our souls. They were linked, exquisitely, arm in arm, marching forward, ever aching for normalcy, for confidence, for happiness. We made a pact, Cess and I, which I'm sharing with you now, a promise that we would stay strong, steady, realize our potential, and not let the mean reds get in the way. Cess found her happiness in Jim. And recently, in beautiful Maddie, she overcame the terrible adversities of her childhood that surely would have crippled anyone else. She built her dream house, had her dream child, and achieved great success in her career. She was so happy that one day last year, when she realized they could walk to Starbucks from the new house, she actually cried. She did. The morning that Cecily died, I arrived at the hospital 50 minutes after she had gone. After Jim grabbed me, held me, and told me she was gone, I went in to see her. She looked peaceful, even beautiful, like she was sleeping. I stood over her bed and I thought, "I wake her up. Cess, wake up. It's a beautiful day, and there's just so much more for us to do." Knowing that her spirit was gone from her physical body, I looked up and I said silently, "Cecily." I hope it made her laugh.
I'm Nancy Lee Myatt. Not an actor. You know, I feel like if I just vamp or stall for 45 minutes, she'll eventually get here. In my worst nightmares, I never imagined that I'd be here at this time in our lives doing this. But I look at this room and I think maybe we should retire Kevin Bacon and play 6 degrees of Cecily Adams. Some of the most significant people in my life right now came to me through Cecily. She did a very good job of casting my life. Cecily and I met the first day of our freshman year at college at UC Irvine. It was 1975. We were 17. You do the math. She was always so worried about telling her true age, so afraid that she'd be too old for this youth-obsessed business that we're in. And all I can think of as I stand here today is that she is too young to be playing this role. For the last 30 years, every thought I had, every decision I made, from carpeting to careers, was informed by Cecily Adams. She helped me choose houses, cars, clothes, jobs, hairstyles, men and women. She helped me understand the rules of romance and friendship and that there was boundaries. She helped me understand the politics of family and business and that there was boundaries. She encouraged me to find true love and not stop until I did, and then allow myself to be loved back. We've done theater, television, and movies together. We've waited on a million tables together. She was a great judge of talent and the lack thereof. In fact, it was Cecily who encouraged me to stop acting and start writing. I think she just wanted me to write material for her, now that I think of that. Okay. We celebrated the birthdays and holidays. I even spent a few Norman Rockwell Thanksgivings at Hollywood Park betting the ponies with she and Don. She'd always bet on me in life, even if I was the long shot, jumping up in class in a wide field on a muddy track. I never laughed more or harder with anyone else in my life than Cecily. Jokes, runners, callbacks. We had so many runners in our lives that I'd forgotten the genesis of most of them. She was sitting in my kitchen last summer trying to get Maddie to eat something, and when Maddie tossed her food across the table for the fifth time, Cecily said, "I'll kill you," and then turned to me and said, "I hope you're happy. I just said, I'll kill you," to my daughter. Other phrases haunt and tease me today. Things like, "You know, they're not good enough for you." Or, "They're children. They weren't even born when Kennedy was assassinated. They have no right to an opinion." Okay, remember, we're 35, which means we were born in 1967, graduated in 1985, and we were alive when they shot Kennedy, Bobby, not JFK. You know, you could always have it liposuctioned. If you live through this, we'll get even, I promise. Oh, come on, if they can do this, we can do this. Look, I know it hurts, but look how skinny you are right now. And why are we laughing? This is so horrible. She used to always accuse me of being some sort of mutant or alien because I can eat and drink anything I want, and survive on very little sleep, and I rarely get sick. And recently, when we were having that discussion again on the way to the hospital for her chemotherapy, she was hungry, and I offered to drive her through Jack in the Box, which was a mortal sin. And by the way, she wasn't always like this. We both lost a lot of brain cells in the 80s. Anyway, she began the lecture. It matters what you eat. It matters what you put into your body, blah, blah. And I looked at her and I said, eat what you want, darling. It doesn't matter. I'm telling you, it doesn't matter. And she said, you know, you're probably right. I did everything right, and look at me. I'm wearing a cardboard belt. Producers, the movie, not the musical. The language of our friendship was a rich shorthand. When we were working on Little Secrets, which was an independent film that was supposed to be shot in 9 days, and as Kathy McNeil likes to say, turn into the best 12 years of our lives. We were filming a scene on the beach in Newport during magic hour, which we really know means magic minute. The sun was dropping, and here we were filming yet another scene from a movie where we were only allowed to have one take. Cecily asked me to tell her what she should be playing for the scene, and the director glared at me. Apparently, I had been giving too much direction. That's so unlike me. So just before the scene started, I looked at Cecily and I marked the scene, scene 52, take one. You see, by this time, there was only three of us left on the crew. And I said one word, caretaker. She got what I wanted, and she played this amazing moment as the sun set into the ocean, and I still think that movie has some of her best work. We were doing a musical called Two on the Isle for Murder, which was a comedy murder mystery. Cecily was playing an amnesia victim who was the poster child for this fundraiser that was the backdrop of this twisted show. And I was playing a tacky country singer. Big stretch, I know. There was this 60s medley, and we did, where I was playing guitar and singing with, I think, Sean and Sharon Lee, and we were being Peter, Paul, and Mary. And, well, I'm one of those people, if you start singing harmony, I will too. And every night from the wings, Cecily would sing my part so that the melody would come through, which became sort of a metaphor for our relationship. And I'm really going to miss her standing in the wings singing for me. She taught me how to let go. It's true. The most controlling person I know gave me the best advice about moving on. About 15 years ago, I went through a difficult time, and she told me that she had watched some of the people that she loved live in pain and sorrow because they never heard the words that they felt they needed to hear in order to heal. Words like, I'm sorry, or I made a mistake, or please forgive me. And she gave me a card during that time, and the words on that card had become my mantra for loss. It simply said, my barn having burned to the ground, I can now see the moon. Well, my barn has burned down, and while I can see the moon, I'm really not ready to look at it without her standing next to me.
My name is Jane George, and I've known Cecily for 20 years. And through the good fortune of our having crossed paths, we'll have the privilege of knowing her forever. I'm going to share a letter with you today that I wrote to Cecily last Sunday. Dear Cecily, in the golden light we call life, there exists a process between individuals, winding and unwinding ourselves around and from each other. This dance of energy engages us in ways that our language cannot explain, our science cannot measure. Our hearts know the movements, but even our hearts are not choreographed to anticipate the next step. And so we move through it with fluidity, and sometimes we fall. Often we get lost and look to the other dancers for the next 8 bars. As you are now in your journey and we are in ours, we have no map to tell us where you are. And so we stand together today, winding and unwinding, searching for answers, letting go of assumptions about how life should be, and death for that matter, while we hold a sacred space for you and your particular journey. Death, like birth, is a beginning, not just for the dying, but for the living as well. Our lives were changed because you touched them. The golden light of life surrounds us today. It holds the essence of you in its warmth and shines brighter because you have become part of it. There is a treasure in the sky, and it is you, Cecily, and we can feel you. And even when the clouds roll in and obstruct my ability to see you, I will always know that you are there, because trees will reach toward you and flowers will bloom because of you. Thank you for your energy and the sustenance it provides for those of us who in time will join you in your vibrancy. Love, Jane.
Hello, my name is Robert Ulrich. I met Cecily in 1986. I hadn't been in Los Angeles very long, and I had just started to work at Reuben Cannon & Associates as a casting assistant. I met Cecily my second or third day of work, and within 5 minutes, we were best friends. She was already a casting director, and she was working for Reuben casting an infomercial before they were called infomercials. She was looking for a beautiful young woman who could be funny, and to be a hostess of sorts, and I said to Cess, I think my wife Kim would be perfect for this. So Cecily looked at Kim's headshot and immediately called her in. Well, the day that Kim came to audition, I wasn't there, I was off at a session somewhere. Kim walked in, sat down to read for Cecily, and Cess began to hyperventilate. That's right, she was having an anxiety attack. Kim jumped up, found a paper bag, told Cess to breathe into it and stay calm. And as Cess said later, she knew Kim for 5 minutes, and they were best friends. Working for Reuben was an amazing experience for all of us who worked for him at that time. It was lots of hard work, lots of long hours, extreme stress, but a great deal of laughter. One time in particular with Cess stands out in my memory. Carol Dudley was Reuben Cannon's right-hand person, and we all worked very closely with her. Now, Carol is a fantastic, wonderful woman, and I'm sure many of you know her. And as the years went by, we all continued working for a while, and then we all became very dear friends with her. But in those days, we were terrified of her. She'd tell us something to do, and we'd all run around like chickens with our head cut off, and we were just utterly frightened. Now, Carol had a habit of saying, I thought I told you. I thought I told you to FedEx this. I thought I told you to mail that. And that became a running joke. Well, one night, it was 9 or 10 o'clock, and we'd had a typical, crazy, stressful day, and the only people left at work were Carol, Cecily, and myself. Now, Carol was standing directly in front of me, and she was telling me something about the politics of South America, and directly behind her was Cecily. Suddenly, without breaking my eye contact with Carol, I focused on Cecily out of the corner of my eye, and I could see her covered in Post-its from the top of her head to her waist. And every Post-it said, I thought I told you. Well, I didn't flinch. I bit the side of my mouth. I didn't even smile. Carol kept talking, and Cecily just stood there. Cecily told me that that was the night I earned her respect. She couldn't believe she didn't make me crack up. Well, that was one of many, many stories that Cecily and I delighted in telling over the years, and no one could tell a story or relive an event like Cecily. When I was asked to speak today, I began reliving the past 18 years, and I realized what an integral part Cecily and Jim have played in our lives. When Cess and Jim were married, Kim was a bridesmaid. When Kim and I moved to Van Nuys, Cess and Jim followed us. When Kim and I needed a therapist, we went to Sess and Jim's. Now, often, in the middle of therapy sessions, and often in some very, very serious moments, for whatever reason, Cecily's name would come up. Now, Piper, our therapist, never revealed a thing about her private life, and most importantly, she would never discuss or even acknowledge that one patient knew another patient. But when Kim or I would mention Cecily, Piper, prim and proper as she was, could not control herself. She would always stifle a laugh because she couldn't think of Cecily without smiling. And I think that that sums up Cecily to me more than anything else. She made me smile. She made me laugh. She made me feel good. You know, it's hard to say something about Cecily that Jim hasn't already said so eloquently in his emails and today. But Cecily was just what you saw. She was determined, stubborn, generous of spirit, passionate, and oh so very compassionate. She wanted the best for all of her friends, and she really wanted the best for the world. She was neurotic, but she was able to laugh at herself about it. And one of the things I think that we all love the most about Cess was her ability to paint a vivid, hilarious picture of whatever outrageous thing she'd done, whether it was saying off, 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 1, 2, 3, 4 to the stove before she left, or calling the police on Jim when she thought he was being mugged in the garage. I mean, the stories went on and on and on, and every time I heard them, usually when I demanded her to tell them, I laughed as heartily as I had the time before, and so did she, and what a great laugh. Every year over a 5-year time period, a group of us would celebrate New Year's Eve together. And the group grew as the years went along, but Eric and Roxanne, Cess and Jim, and Kim and I were always part of the equation. The first year, we rented a cabin, and at midnight, Cecily made us all go out on the deck and look up at the stars and be still and share our hopes and dreams with each other and make a wish for the new year. This was the kind of beautiful sentimentality that was indicative of Cess. And now, whenever I look up at the stars, I will think of you, Cecily, and I'll know that you are thinking of us, too. Cecily was special. She was unique. She was unlike anyone else. And that might be why the loss is so unfathomable, why the missing her is so difficult to bear. But Cecily lives on in so many ways, in the joy she brought, in the countless stories that will be told and retold, and in her precious Maddie. Kim and I feel blessed to have known her, to have been a part of her life, to be a part of Jim and Maddie's lives. And we will never forget her.
Let me get this straight. When you needed therapy, you went to Jimmy and Cess? My name is Tom Allard, and I have always thought of Jim as a partner in sleeping crime. I was the best man at Jimmy and Cess's marriage, and Cess was not one to suffer fools gladly. When they announced they were being married, I went to Cecily and said, with great earnestness, "Do you really love him?" And she said, "I've just agreed to be called Cecily Adams Beaver for the rest of my life." Yeah, I love him. I taught Cecily how to fire a handgun because Jimmy was frequently on location and she wanted to feel more comfortable. So I took her to the firing range, and as with many of the people in this room, I used to earn my living playing the bad guys, shooting it out with a hero. So I dutifully taught Cecily the two-handed combat firing position. She turned out to be an automatic, natural, and deadly accurate marksman. With a twist. Because every time she fired, she stepped into it. It was like an old comedian leaning into a punchline. Wonder where she got that. She emptied the first clip into the 5-0 ring. Everyone got it by that much. I've been through this before. And I know that where we are right now is composed of two parts. What it is and what it means. What it is the ache of absence, which we all share. That part of us that was filled by Cecily has an echo, and it hurts. And what it means, and what it means is get off your ass. Tomorrow is promised to no one. You want to sing, sing. You want to dance, dance. You want to learn to play the bagpipes, move neck to some Mormons, and get started. If you want to write a letter to the White House and tell them you think that guy's full of shit, get some paper. Hell, I got some stamps. I heard someone say recently it isn't fair. She should have had a second chance. Life is not and cannot be judged that way. Fairness is what we give each other. And a second chance like acceptance and forgiveness are products of the human heart. Tomorrow is promised to no one. And that thing about the letter, I've got the stamps on me.
Outfit.
Hello, Roxanne.
Monica! Hi. Lauren, gee, you look wonderful.
Thank you, Roxanne. You look the same.
Thank you. Where should I put this?
I'll take them. Grab some champagne.
Ooh, champagne. I forgot this was a grown-up slumber party.
Yeah.
Patrick? Was that your hand?
No.
That was not your hand?
Well, yeah.
You?
Oh! I can answer that.
Roxanne, you don't have to raise your hand anymore.
Oh, that's right. Okay, it's because the boys always liked to look at Jamie, but they always knew that they could, you know, with Liz. I feel safe with you guys, you know?
Please don't take that away from me. I will never make it if I have to walk out that door and back into my life without all of you guys as my friends.
Oh, yes, I know them all. But I always approach a customer as soon as I can. You watch me. Why? Just tell me why.
I got a girl in my office, rape and battery. Her mother doesn't want her to press charges.
Keep talking to her until I'm finished with these and then bring her in. Yeah.
Are you ready for this? This girl is raped and beaten, and the mother absolutely refuses to allow us to take it to court. She just took her daughter away.
So what did we lose?
Raped on a first date, kid into everything at school.
No other witnesses?
I don't know why this one's getting to me so much.
What is it you think you could have done?
I must look stupid.
Hey, forget how it looks.
How do you get through it? When do you stop feeling so much?
You're very good at what you do.
I envy you sometimes. How you can just cut yourself off. Well, thanks for letting me sound off like a kid.
You're even more handsome than you were in the magazine. Can I have your autograph?
Please, call me Al.
I'm such a fan of your show.
Well, it's very gratifying to hear. Tim and I always try to do our best.
Who's Tim?
Oh.
Hi, Doris.
Happy Secretary's Day.
Yeah,
Dennis, happy Secretary's Day. Maybe Jack will get you an assortment of jams. Dennis loves jams.
I advise young women on issues related to abortion. Ms. Vogel, were you arrested for trespass in 1993? Yes. I was arrested during a pro-life demonstration at a women's clinic in Mar Vista.
You're an abortion counselor, and yet you participated in a pro-life demonstration.
Well, I don't consider the two incompatible.
I mean, the only choice you offer is going through with the pregnancy.
As God intended.
Is it possible, Ms. Vogel, that Sharon Rooney went to your center not understanding just what type of services you provided?
It's possible.
What was the last thing you said to her?
I told her that if she aborted her baby, that God would never forgive her.
Well, then you consider Sharon a murderer, whether she killed the two victims in this case or not, don't you?
Well, if she had an abortion, then that's what she is.
You must be my new secretary.
Hi, Van Dunn. Really, really so great to meet you.
Do I have any messages today?
Oh, like a billion.
Maybe you could give me the first 100,000.
Oh, I didn't write any of them down. I had like a trillion other things on my mind. Besides, they told me that you weren't coming in today, so I figured, why take a message? And by the way, these chocolates came for you. There was like a gazillion butter creams in there, but I ate them, you know? But you weren't coming in.
I thought so from the picture, but...
His name is Philip Carter. He's 34. You noticed him in the bar before he attacked you.
I'm not sure. He looked different in the lineup.
He looked different when he was raping you, too. It's still the same man. You left the bar after midnight. Before you could get into your car, he grabbed you and pushed you inside. He held a knife to your face. He wanted you to be afraid. When he was finished, he told you about the AIDS. He told you he was sorry. Then he flicked the knife open and used it to cut off your hair. A souvenir. Look at him. Look closely. All you have to do is remember. This is the man who raped you, isn't it? The same man you saw at the lineup.
Yes.
This will go away. But the fear won't unless you help us now.
Love you too, Quark. But when you say living together, what are we talking about? A day? A week? 2 weeks?
What's wrong? Did the nigga say no?
Don't you think about anyone but yourself?
Of course I do.
He left me. All I asked him was to reinstate your license. I'm not gonna lie to you, Zeki. I believe in equal rights for females. And someday I hope you will too. But I'd never do anything to hurt you.
What about all those rumors that Quark told me?
They were lies. Tell him, Quark.
I guess I stretched the truth here and there.
Now the question is, what am I gonna do with you?
Anything you want.
What man could resist an offer like that?
Down. trouble melts like lemon drops. High above the chimney top, that's where you find me, oh, somewhere over the rainbow. Bluebirds fly.
Well, how bad do you feel for me having to go after that? I was fine, you know, until... Okay. My name is Linda Wallum, and I had the pleasure of working with Cecily. And like Jane, I also wrote a letter. You know, Jim, I should have brought the puppets. It would have made it easier. You know. Excuse me. Okay. See, at this point, Cecily would say, okay, come back in, Linda, but bring it down a little. Okay. Dear Cecily, okay, here's the thing. I'm sitting at my desk looking at the refrigerator magnet of you and Maddie, and I can't believe you're gone. All I can do is write you this letter and tell you some things I should have told you a long time ago. You were by far my favorite person to work with. I did the math, and I figured after two shows and a pilot over a six-year period, we must have talked on the phone at least 30 times a day, sat in casting sessions together a total of at least a month or two. The point is, I've spent more time with you than I have most of my family, and that's a good thing. It never felt like work with you, Cess. It felt like I was playing hooky with my best friend so we could eat zone bars and gossip. Speaking of our gossip sessions, I feel I owe you an amends. I'm truly, truly sorry I made fun of your freaky obsession with Gene Wilder. And I forgive you for mocking my obsession with Doris Day. People need to know how good you were at your job. You were amazing with actors. When you read with them in sessions, you made them better. Last year, when you were casting my pilot, we were in a casting session with the studio. You left the room to get the next actor, and the president of the studio stated that you should play the part. Everyone agreed. The problem was the part was a 14-year-old boy, but whatever, that's how good you were. I think people also need to know about your two major casting injuries you sustained while on the job. You know these stories, so hold on a minute while I fill them in. Okay, the super glue. Apparently, I made Cecily tell me this story whenever I was depressed. I must have heard it a dozen times, but she was casting a commercial for super glue. And apparently the actors came in and had to hang from the helmet, you know, the helmet glued to the, and they had to pretend they were hanging there. And so they held on to something, and Cecily thought, well, I want the guy to look like he's swinging. So she went up and pushed his legs so he'd swing, and he knocked her right in the eye with his boot. Okay, just her eye. Whoa. She said it was like my eye exploded. It felt awful. They run me to the hospital. Her eye is just terrible. Somebody called Jim. So Jim shows up at the emergency room, and Jim had been working that day. I'm not sure what it was, but he was playing apparently a very dirty, scary, bloody, bruises on the knuckles drug addict. Cecily said that Jim walked in, and the doctor looked at her eye and looked at Jim's knuckles, and Jim slowly just did this. And kept asking her if she wanted to talk to somebody after, if got Jim out of the room, whatever. Okay, love that story. The other injury she sustained was another eye injury. Last year during my pilot, I came down to her office to say, you know, we had a session, and I said, gee, where's Cecily? And she said, oh, she got hurt in her office. And I said, well, did an actor hit her or something? What? No, she poked her eye with a pencil. I said, well, how did she do that? Well, her mom called and she picked up the phone and had a pencil and it went in her eye. So because of the super glue story, I knew she'd be horrified. So I sat in her office and waited, and she came back with a big patch on her eye. And she said, well, let's go back to work. I said, we don't have to. She said, no, we got actors. So the actors started coming in. And after the fourth actor, she finally said, come on in. Hi, I poked my eye out with a pencil. It hurts. Wasn't that stupid? Sit down and read. Okay. Okay, back to my letter. One of my other favorite memories of you is chewing out an agent online, putting him on hold, and taking a call from Jim so you could talk to Maddie in the most loving, tender voice. It went something like this. What do you mean he's in second position? You promised me. No, 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 no. Hold on. Is Jim on too? Okay, hi. Hi, honey. Hi. Yeah. Did she eat something? Okay, hold on. No, 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 no. I'm not speaking to you. I thought we had a relationship. Goodbye. Hi, honey. Oh, wait, no. Oh. Anyway, she called the agent honey and was horrified, but. Cecily, thank you for last summer when I was completely suicidal because my pilot was not picked up and depressed that you showed me your house. You had just bought it, and you showed me where everything was going to be and what you were going to add on. Your joy and excitement was a wonderful thing to share with me. Thank you for calling me down to your office every time Jim stopped by with Maddie. Thank you for letting me be there with you for the last 4 months. I promised to take Jim out for steak and beers, and I promised to tell Maddie stories of her funny, courageous, talented, sometimes cranky mother, who loved her more than anything in the world. And I'll try to explain the Gene Wilder thing. I love you, Linda.
Hi, my name is Jean Doherty. I met Cess in 1984. She was helping out with the show that I was doing at the Theater West. As it turns out, that show featured a very talented actor named Paul Winfield, whose passing is also being mourned and celebrated today. Sometimes there's a lot for us mere mortals to deal with. About a year later at Theater West, I found myself part of a team of producers who were producing a new play series. The highlight of the series was a play by a relatively new member of the company, Jim Beaver. Cess came to one of the shows one night. We all went out to dinner afterwards at a restaurant called Finkel Express down in Cahuenga. Now, Jim says Kathy Sandridge introduced him to Cess. And I'm sure that's probably true. But that night at dinner, Jim and Cess didn't know each other real well, and they were having a conversation, and it was interesting to watch. There was this bantering going back and forth, you know, barbs being shot. And I'm looking at them, and I'm thinking, well, they like each other. Well, it turns out Jim was living across the street from me at the time. He was house-sitting for Catherine Lee Scott. And Jim's idea of a balanced meal at that time was to crack open a can of pork and beans, throw in the fork, and go at it. So we used to invite him to dinner a lot. So after this thing that happened at L'Express, I started saying, Jim, why don't you invite, you know, Cecily out? I think she's cute. I think, you know, I'm always trying to fix people up. So this was sort of, you know, pretty standard for me. And Jim, you know, kind of put me off. So then I came up with an idea, and I said, Jim, you know, I want you to come to dinner, but, you know, I want Cess to come too. And, you know, call her. Tell Cess I want her to come to dinner. You know, you can do that for me. And I don't know. I mean, after a while, I think finally Jim did that. It took a while. I don't think I had to nag him too much, although I seem to remember thinking, Jim's awfully stubborn, you know. Or maybe it was just like he didn't like having people tell him what to do, and he was going to do what he wanted to do in his own time, and he sure did. And I think we all know the rest of the Jim and Cecily story. As the years went on, we all stayed close, a lot of us from Theater West. There was a game we played. It was called Trivial Pursuit. We started playing Trivial Pursuit in 1985. We're still playing Trivial Pursuit. First, we used to play it several times a year. We'd all get together once a month or so, and that kind of fell off a bit. And then finally, when Bill and I moved up north, we just started playing it when we would come back in town. I'd go online, I'd say, Jim and Bill and I are coming down to town on such and such a days, and here's the Trivial Pursuit night, be there. And as often as not, you know, we'd have it at Jim and Cecily's house, partly because Bill and I used to always kind of like staying there because they had a nice guest bedroom with a queen-size bed. And it was at the Trivial Pursuit games that we heard the now famous Cecily in the Jungle with the Trekkies story. And if you haven't heard it, you've missed a classic. It was at a Trivial Pursuit game that Jim and Cecily, and I, this is just as clear as yesterday in my mind, told me that they would not be able to join me in Havana for New Year's because they had something else going on in August. And they told us that Cess was pregnant. And a little more than a year or so after that, we were back in L.A., and it was again as a Trivial Pursuit game, that I walked in and met Miss Maddie for the first time. She took one look at me, a total stranger, the brow furrowed. I don't know if you knew Maddie back then, but she had an astonishing furrow in her brow, and I thought, wow, is that Cecily or what? Many, many, many fond memories. I'm going to read a poem. This is a poem that my husband Bill sent to Jim the day Cecily died, and he asked us to read it. It's by Robert Louis Stevenson. Though she, that ever kind and true, kept stoutly step by step with you, your whole long, gusty lifetime through, be gone a while before, yet doubt not. Soon the seasons shall restore your girl to you. She has but turned a corner. Still, she pushes on with right good will through mire and marsh, by hue and hill, that self-same arduous way that you and she through many a doubtful day attempted still. She is not dead, this girl, not dead. But in the path we mortals tread, got some few trifling steps ahead and nearer to the end, so that you too, once past the bend, shall meet again as face to face this friend you fancy dead. Push gaily on, strong heart. The while you travel forward mile by mile, she loiters with a backward smile till you can overtake, and strains her eyes to search her wake, or, whistling as she sees you through the break, waits on a stile. Thank you.
I'm the above-referenced Bill. Last name Wood. We must stop meeting like this. I have a poem to read you. It's dated March 2nd, 2004, and it's for Jim. Can you sleep in your bed? Can you sit in your chair? Can you still drink the water? Can you still breathe the air? Can you still make your lunch? Can you sweeten your tea? Can you walk to the corner, park under a tree? Can you take in a stray cat? Set a plant on the stair? Or stand in a doorway and not see her there? Is she real or a phantom? Do you want her or not? Would she smile if you kissed her? Is she cold and you hot? Is the end just beginning? Are you ready for this? The thin breath of evening in place of a kiss? Is there one jot of meaning in all of this pain? If she turned up tonight, would you love her again? Now you know what you know, and you've seen what you've seen, and nothing that happens or ever has been can happen without her. To touch and to cherish, can the earth still support you? Or will it all perish as Cecily perished and left you behind and stopped up your ears and struck you stone blind and cut off your fingers and cut out your heart? Can you limp to the finish? Is it pointless to start? You lie in a vacuum where everything's dead. Though the questions have answers, there's still suns ahead. So sleep in your bed and sit in your chair and drink at the window and watch for her there. The loss is so great that there's nothing to win. Just start counting shadows. Just wait. Just begin.
She had opinions. By the train load. George Bush was the devil. That's George Bush Senior. She wouldn't even talk about Junior. She hated right-wing politicians, the criminal justice system, stunt casting, nineteen-year-olds playing lawyers, jazz. Because it reminded her painfully of her mother's unjustly unrewarded singing career. She hated pollution, corporate greed, and any form of unfairness. She loved, more than anything else on earth, her daughter Maddie. Other things she loved included Mel Brooks movies, James Taylor, Survivor and American Idol, Law and Order, old growth forests, travel, animals, the books of Paul Theroux and Tolkien and Harry Potter. She loved documentaries about prisons and serial killers and air disasters. She loved me to read to her. She loved to read to Maddie. And she loved music. She loved to listen to it, to play it, to sing it. She wrote dozens of songs with her partner David Burke, And if she hadn't had drives in so many other directions, she might well have found fame as a lyricist. She wrote, with David, a song for our wedding as a gift for me. Speaking as objectively as I can, it is far and away the best wedding song I have ever heard. For our 10th anniversary, I had an idea. I called David Burke, and I told him I wanted to have a terrific singer, Armelia McQueen, record the song on CD as my anniversary gift to Cess. David was stunned, because unbeknownst to me, Cess had called David not quite an hour before to suggest recording the song herself as her gift to me. In something out of a French farce, our recording sessions were scheduled back to back. And David went nuts trying to keep us from seeing each other. After my singer finished, David suggested I might have fun singing the song myself. So just for kicks, I did. Later, David gave each of us separately our CDs and made each of us promise not to listen to it until we listened to it with each other. So Cess and I went to Italy for our anniversary. And in a moonlit cliffside cafe on the Amalfi Coast, we gave each other our gifts. Both of us were surprised to be getting and receiving 10th anniversary gifts of a CD player with dual headphones. But the biggest surprise was David's, because when we played the CDs, this is what we heard.
Spent my days staring at the sun and the wind, I would follow where it blew, spinning high and low. I didn't know all along I was looking for you.
I have spent my time trying not to feel, all the while never knowing what was wrong, building walls so high, I guess that I was looking for you all along.
All my life I've waited for tonight. I see your eyes and I know what to do. My heart's in your hands, and everything I am, from now on I'll share with you. From time to time, I would find someone when the longing was hardest to get through. In a clever disguise, but in their eyes all along I was looking for you.
Now those days are gone and the time is here, as you stand before me brave and true. And I swear I'm sure that we'll endure all along I've been looking for you.
See your eyes and I know what to do. My heart's in your hands, and everything I am, from now on I'll
Hello, my name is Drew, and I'm a cessaholic. David Burke, I don't know how you did that. That was amazing. I met Cess about 20 years ago, one of the Theater West, and privileged also to be one of the Trivial Pursuit players. I had the privilege of working with Cess in a way that I don't think many of you have here, in that I was directed by Cess on purpose a couple of times. And Cess as a director was really extraordinary. She brought together everything that was beautiful about her as a person, as well as her immense skills in the art that we all share. I'm not good at telling stories, and so what I've put together is the top 10 lessons I learned from her direction, from her friendship, from her life, and from her death. Lesson number 10 is know what you want and go for it. Lesson number 9 is find ways to get past anything that stands in your way. Lesson number 8 is that it is a cruel illusion to believe that logic has anything to do with life, human behavior, or death. Lesson number 7, there's no point trying to control everything because we have control over nothing. Lesson number 6 is that neuroses do not diminish the size of one's heart. Lesson number 5 is that under the right circumstances and with appropriate constraints, some value can be found in hanging out with writers. Lesson number 4, you don't know what you got till it's gone. Lesson number 3, death is a transition, not a termination. Lesson number 2, love trumps fear. Lesson number 1, indescribable sweetness describes exactly. During the last couple of days, a bonus lesson keeps crossing my mind along the lines of something Tom had to say, which for me is best captured by the words of William Saroyan: in the time of your life, live. In the time of your life, live, so that in that wondrous time you shall not add to the misery and sorrow of the world, but shall smile to the infinite delight and mystery of it. In the time of your life, live. And I would add to that, in the time of your life, love. Thank you, Cess.
What does she have in her hand?
My name is Carolyn Hennessy, and this is how I know Cecily. Nothing I tried to write was adequate, so I can only offer a brief snapshot of the woman that we have come to celebrate and honor. Jim called me a few days ago and asked if I would speak kind of as a representative from her improv days. And I said, well, Jim, when Cecily and I were at the Acme Comedy Theater together, we were in different companies, different branches of the theater. And he said, it doesn't matter. And I thought, well, then I'll tell the story of how Cecily and I met. Because it perfectly illustrates something that Jim said earlier, how she responded to an unevolved individual. Me. I was in the main company doing a show using this wig. And I walked in one day, and Cecily was in the B company, the kids. And I noticed that my wig was had been moved. It was out of place, I think. A curl was strangely lopsided or something like that. At any rate, it had been moved. So I wrote a note. And I put it, I don't even remember where I put it, but I put it in the dressing room and I said, to whoever used my wig, you know how we do it in the theater, and blah, 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 and blah, 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 and professional. And keep your paws off is basically what I said. And I came back the next week and found a note waiting for me, which said essentially, I'm sorry, the wig had fallen on the floor, I didn't know whose it was, I just use it briefly for a sketch, and perhaps in the future you might just consider not being such a self-important tight ass. Whereupon I wrote a note and said, yeah, well, yeah, oh, I don't know what I said, but both of us had our, we had our fighting suits on. And I had not met her. We had not met each other. Just the wig. A very short time later, I was called in to read for a role on something or other. Yeah. And I'm all perky in my little suit, and out from her office comes this beautiful young woman, who walks up to me and says, hi, I'm Cecily Adams. And I then, and I thought, I'm going down. Like the Titanic. I just didn't know when, at what part of the audition, I would break in two and sink. She could not have been more gracious. She could not have been more supportive. Not a word was spoken about that. Later on, I might have been, may have even been on the set, I don't know. I walked up to Cecily and I said, I'm the one with the wig. And she looked at me and she said, I know. And in that moment, I became a better person because I saw in front of me a woman who met smallness and pettiness and stupidity, also known as being an actor, with generosity, with kindness of spirit, with a largesse that defined her. She was not only a brilliant teacher, she didn't just teach me to be a better actor, which she did. She taught me to be a better person, not to sweat the small stuff, to give over to the humanity that's in every individual. And she and I became tremendous friends. And I am grateful to that wig, very grateful to the wig. I'll just close by saying there is a play by Christopher Marlowe called Tamburlaine the Great. Tamburlaine, for those of you who don't know, is a shepherd who conquers the world. And the world that he has to conquer is very bloody and mighty, and it's big, it's huge, but he is conquered by love. He's conquered by a woman who he marries and he has a family with. And this woman is taken from him very early, too early. She's very young, and Tamburlaine stands. And he raises his head to the gods, and he says, it's a paraphrase, but it applies. You have her now. She is yours. She is dancing for you. She is making you smile. All the things that she did for us, she is doing for you. And we are bereft. But if you ever tire of her, send her back. Send her back to us. I will treasure her always, her spirit, her person, her memory. Thank you.
I am Armin Shimmerman, and this may be a surprise to the family, but I'm Cecily's 54-year-old son. She had me in another life, actually on another planet. For those of you, all of you, I suppose, who saw the clip, I was the young Ferengi. I am very honored. Jim asked me to come and speak today. The world has been too much with me recently, and I'll be short. Each of us belongs to a different circle of friends to Cecily. I'm sort of an adjunct to the rat pack that she belonged to of high school, college friends. My wife, Kitty Swink, and I got attached to that rat pack pretty early on, and our lives were changed. Cecily and I were together, I can't count them, but I would say somewhere from 6 to 8 episodes on Star Trek. As you saw from the clip, there was a lot of makeup. It probably took her 2 to 3 hours every day she worked to get into that makeup. It's difficult. It's claustrophobic. It itches. And it's maddening for anyone who wears it on their face. And she never complained. She complained. She complained a lot. She complained so much that Max and Aaron and I got tired of her complaining, because after all, we were wearing the same fucking makeup. And then she got to hitting each of us on the head. You saw it in the clip. She's like that, as though the rubber head actually would save us from that. It's very thin rubber. She also, we worked probably 16 hours a day, longer if you include Cecily's makeup, probably 17 hours. And we laughed. We laughed all day long. And Cecily kept us happy, kept us amused. And as much as she complained about the makeup, it never got to her, and she always kept her sense of humor. And I defy anyone in the TV industry to find better romantic comedy scenes than the ones she played with Wallace Shawn. She was brilliant. And she always said, can we do one more take? Can we do one more take? She wanted it to be perfect. And almost all of the time, it was. The character was called Ishka, but her two sons, myself as Quark and Max Gradenshek as Rom. We called her Moogie. And if you say Moogie to a Star Trek fan anywhere in the world, they will think Cecily Adams. And those performances and that talent and that dedication will live forever in the franchise, so that when Maddie grows up, she'll be able to see those performances all over again and know what the world saw in her talent. And I'm only grateful that I was there at the beginning.
My name is Glenn Morshauer. About 2 minutes ago, my dear friend Jerry Price leaned over and said, "Baby, are you ready?" And Jerry, the answer is yes and no. When I look out and consider the question, do I believe in eternal life? The answer is an emphatic yes, because I am looking at it. I'm looking at a theater full of eternal life. And Cecily is with each of us. I want to say that this, Jim, is the best memorial service I have ever attended, which is so right and so appropriate and so not surprising at all. My whole life, I was always puzzled at how quickly an entire life can be swept under the rug and forgotten about because we're in such a hurry to wrap it up in an hour. Services are held by ministers who never knew the deceased, which I consider tragic. And today is the polar opposite of that. And I'm honored to be here. So the segue from best service leaves me to wanting to tell you about the worst audition that Cecily shared with me she had ever seen. I tell the story of this audition in a course I teach. I've been traveling around the country teaching a course called The Extra Mile. Cecily and I have taught together. And the story goes like this. The actor walked into the room with props and wardrobe. Scary signs number 1 and 2. The actor then took a deep breath, got down on the floor, and did not 1, not 5, but 25 push-ups. When he was finished, he said, "Cecily, ask, are you ready?" Because while he was doing them, the producers are just looking at themselves, wondering, who is this schmuck? Schmuck is not a word we grew up saying in Texas, Jim. But then he started, and he said, "Okay." With improvement, his reading could have sucked. When he finished, he said, "You know, I was skiing at Big Bear this weekend, and on the way home, I hit something." At this point, Cecily said, "Please God, let there be an earthquake." "And do you know that what I hit, upon closer inspection, once I got home, my home is Studio City, it was a bat. There was a bat on my windshield, and it was still alive." And I didn't know what to do with it, so I looked in the trunk of my car where I found a jar with tacks. I emptied the tacks out, I put the bat in the jar, and I put the jar in the freezer. Having poked air holes in the jar. Now, I don't know about you guys, but if it were my commitment to elongate the bat's life, I don't think I'd have been allowing him to take a nap in the freezer. Not so coincidentally, the next morning, the bat died, and I wrote a poem about it. And here is that poem. She swore to me that the poem was on the old-fashioned computer paper, the kind that when you open it, it goes rolling out across the floor. I wrote a couple of quick ones since we're winding up here, and then I have a letter. I, too, am a letter writer. I wrote a letter to Cess. But I want to tell you, and I know my nickname is Larry Long-Winded Jim, but I'm really working to do this right. Bill Anderson is the gentleman who cut together the video, right, Jim? Didn't Bill do that? And to say it was lovely, Bill, is the understatement of a lifetime. I'm glad that I got to see it halfway through the service so that I could do my bawling in my chair. Thank you so very much. Now let me tell you a little bit about the fun that Cecily poked at you without you knowing about it. Jay Downing, Cecily, Jim, and myself, and I'm sure some others, in the early stages of our careers as actors were doing May Company training films. And Bill wrote them, directed them, edited them, the whole thing. So our soundstage was the May Company in North Hollywood. In post-production, after we had seen your films, Bill, Cecily would come over to the house, and I still have these, Jim, if you'd like to see them. Jim is not aware of what I'm about to share. We redubbed your videos in a really racy and dirty manner. One of the scenes I remember in particular is these were all about sales techniques, and she was talking to a man, and the camera was on Cecily's backside so that we didn't have to match her lips, and we could frankly get away with murder. Anything we wanted to say, and this man was so enthusiastic, yes ma'am, very enthusiastic employee. And so what we had Cess redub in is, you know, when you have time, I'd like to go back into the dressing room and slap you around a little bit with whips and chains. And he would eagerly say, oh, I'd like that. And they are just precious, Jim. And Carolyn and I were thinking about that this morning. Cecily, Bill, Tebby, and I went to Vegas with $1,100 between the three of us when we were in our early 20s. We came back with 10 between the three of us, and all three of us were so busted that we jumped into the Landmark Hotel, which is no longer there. We jumped into their swimming pool in our clothes. Cecily, when I was holding her hand at her bedside in their beautiful home, looked at me and said, you know the Christopher Reeve story you tell in your lectures, Glenn? She said, right now, I would trade all this and everything I had for Jim, Maddie, and a street corner. When I left the room, and these were our final words to each other, I said, I love you. And she said, I love you too. And we blew kisses to each other because there was concern about germs and things, which I certainly understood. Cecily and I burned clean, and I want to tell you, for 23 years, there hasn't been a regret. All I wanted was more time doing the same thing. No unspoken words, zero unfinished business. And here is the letter. I wrote this the morning I got the news. March 3rd. Dear Cecily, we have been friends for a very long time. Take your pick how you say it. Since March of 81,
or since I had hair. Thank you for sharing your life with me. Thank you for bringing me joy. Thank you for bringing me laughter. Thank you for bringing me love. Thank you for doing the Womp Hopper stomp with me, which is the dance number I saw her doing. Thank you for turning me on to the music of George Winston. Thank you for spending all of those late nights playing poker with the gang. Jay, T, Marty, Vince, Tim, George, Don, Nevin, and Bill. You asked me once if you were an easy read. Let me say it again. Yes. But only very much so. In fact, a flashing neon sign on your forehead proclaiming I have the winning hand would have been less subtle. I enjoyed knowing about each other's upbringing, yours in Maryland and California, mine in Texas. I loved walking on my elementary school lawn with you in Dallas. Thank you for allowing me to stand in total honesty with you. Thank you for casting me in several projects. It is interesting how that stopped when you met Jim. It's true. Whenever you were reading me for something after you were married, I knew that meant Jim was already booked elsewhere. I think this is called keeping it in the family. Thank you for babysitting Greg and Emily so that I could drive across town in 3 hours of traffic and rain for a commercial audition where I pretended to be watching a cheeseburger drive by. Thank you for teaching with me in Dallas, in Burbank, and most recently last summer at Theater West when you asked me to join you in helping raise money for your nanny's husband who was battling leukemia. I was honored to have been able to do the same thing for you a few weeks ago. I know the sold-out evening confirmed for you how much you are loved. I'm glad that you experienced marriage and that it was with Jim, who is a 5-star class act. I am glad that you experienced being a mom. Maddie is absolutely beautiful. I'm glad that you experienced people handing you money for your 8x10 at Star Trek conventions. I'm thankful for all of our soul-sharing lunches, especially those where Jay, you, and myself shared our birthdays in the spring. And our dinners. It seems neither one of us were big on breakfast. In fact, the only morning munch we ever shared was at Winchell's at the corner of Moore Park in Vineland after an all-night poker game where we discussed the guilt we were both feeling after buying our donuts with what used to be our friend's money. I'm thankful to have met most of your immediate family and that you also met mine. I'm so very thankful that you, Jim, and I had dinner with Mom and Pop in our Dallas home, and I appreciated you guys meeting up with them again in New York. Cess, you are a rare and needed breed of human being. You served as a safe landing place for me in an often confusing world. We spoke the same spiritual and emotional language. My life is infinitely better off having crossed paths with you. We not only crossed paths, we grabbed each other's hand, and we said, hey, I really understand your soul, so let's not let go, and we haven't for 23 years, nor do we now. We are all in the same parade. Some of us here today can't see you right now because your line of the marching band we're in, your line has simply turned the corner, and the illusion is that you are gone. The truth is, you are simply playing your instrument on a different street, the same one we will all join you on one day. I describe my friendship with you as perfect and I am thrilled that we went to Earth School together. I experience God in your midst. I describe my friendship. Sorry. You taught me many things. I love you, Cess, today and always. The world feels lonelier without you, but there is genuine comfort for us all in knowing that you will be waiting on the other side.
Am I up? That took a half hour. You may not recognize me, but I am the dominating father that my daughter Stacy so kindly pointed out earlier. I'm here to tell you about my last moments with Cecily, but I must warn you, I'm a crier, and whether I can get through this without crying, I find as we get older, we cry more readily. I cried at the slides. I cried when my daughter got big laughs. Cockfights. Tijuana is a long place to go for a good cry. Anyway, I must get to the point because it's getting late, and I must tell you about my last moments with my daughter. They're starting to go. I went to the hospital to see her, and at this point, her condition was negative. What they call negative, hopeless. I went in to see her. Jim was there and other people who were sleeping around, keeping her company, who loved her. I sat by her bedside and held her hand, and she looked so beautiful, so calm, that I couldn't believe that she was sick. And then she turned to me and said, "Daddy, I'm scared." I didn't know what to say. I couldn't say, "Well, everything's going to be all right." And then I remembered a poem that I'd learned when I was young called Invictus. And I held her hand and I said, "Out of the night that covers me, black as a pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishments the scroll. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. In the fell clutch of circumstance, I have not winced nor cried aloud. Under the bludgeonings of chance, my head is bloody, but unbowed." Jim was there, and he told me that he think that it helped her. I hope it did. I loved her. I didn't know her as closely or as familiarly as most of you people here. I looked at the screen tonight and saw something that I never knew existed. I thank you for that.
Stacy and I, on behalf of all of our family, our blood family, our extended family, all of you who are family, I want to thank you for joining us here today to celebrate someone that I think all of us know better now, and I'm sorry that it took this for that knowledge to come. Cecily and I were members of Theater West for 20-something years now. Theater West was home. It was an artistic haven. It was a place where, gosh, for the first 5-6 years I was in L.A., I don't think I knew anybody who wasn't a member there. It was home. I still go and stand on the spot on the sidewalk in front of the theater where Cecily placed those two kisses on my cheeks. One of the wonderful things about the theater company there is their sense of family. And there's a tradition that has dated back to the beginnings of Theater West, and I've always found it a lovely, wonderful one. And it is when one of our members moves on, we gather, we share, we celebrate, and then we close with that most theatrical of farewells, a standing ovation. And so Stacy and I would like to invite all of you to join us in a last bow for our dear sweet Cecily. That she would have loved. Thank you all for coming.